The Holy Gospel for the third Sunday of Lent is from the Gospel according to St. John, the second chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. And this is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Here again, the words of Paul: "For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength." Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So now that you know where that little prayer comes from Psalm 19. Also comes from Psalm 118. And it comes from about two or three other psalms. So it tells me that the words of our mouth mean something. And the meditations of our hearts mean something. The thoughts that are in our hearts and the words that we speak have validity and strength and purpose. And that sounds so foolish when you think about it, but then again, we're just human beings. According to God, we're all a bunch of fools. Paul even says that he's a fool for Jesus, and I think that's a good thing to be thinking about. Are we fools for Jesus? Do we put God first and foremost in our lives, or do we allow the world to creep in and rob our joy? Shift our focus and make it so hard for us to see the blessings that are there for us all the time. Jesus goes up at Passover time. The position of his story in the Gospel of John is right after he turns lots and lots of water into wine. Pretty impressive stuff. Then he goes up to Jerusalem for the Passover, and he's upset with the critters in the place. He's upset and chases out the cattle and the sheep and the doves. He overturns the money changers' tables and says, "This is not a marketplace. This is a house of prayer." And then he says, "So you destroy this temple in 3 days, and I will raise it up again." And they're looking and saying, "Well, this temple's been under construction for 46 years. And as I said last night, it's kind of like Interstate 29 in Sioux City. It just never is done." Yeah, people that have to go to 29, they know. It's a zoo there, and you have to pay attention so carefully, because all of a sudden you want to exit, and your exit egress was a mile back, and you're just doomed. My cousin used to work in St. Luke's, and she lived in Morningside, which is east of St. Luke's. And she would take Hamilton, because I had told her how to get to her house the easiest way. And she'd go, "I'm going to South Dakota." And I'm like, "Oh, no, don't take that exit." And so she got better at not going to South Dakota, but then she called me to go out to Nebraska. And how often do we get caught up motion on your phone, but you actually have to turn the lens to focus. That's what we're called to do as followers of Jesus Christ. To focus. That's the wisdom of God, is placing our focus on the Lord and every day doing it again. And then you'll find that there is still stuff that's going to try to take your focus. There are still problems that are not fun. There are still things going on that are just not pleasant or are painful or are sad. That's all still there. But you realize if you focus on the Lord that you have the strength to move forward. That's how that works. After all, we heard today God's 10 commandments. And they're very clear top commandments. They use rather small words, except for that iniquity part. They're real simple. She'll have no other gods. And Luther's catechism says, what does this mean? What is this? It means we're to fear and love God above all things. And every explanation of those commandments follows with, we're to fear and love God, so that. And the so that is how we live in community with one another. So if we keep our focus on God and have Him be number one in our lives, you know, if God were good at marketing, He'd have those foam number one pants to wear, you know, I'm number one. If we keep our focus on the Lord, things get better. And they stay better. That's the wisdom of following God. The foolishness is the world will always say, this is important right now. Do this right now. Focus on this right now. Go do this right now. And we as followers of Jesus can say, oh, back the bus up. Let me focus on what God wants and then proceed. That doesn't give us license to sit somewhere and contemplate our belly buttons, although that's not a bad thing to do for a stretch of time. It's always good to get away for a little bit and refocus, but it's for us to have the strength and wisdom to walk out there, be our very best selves, and be examples for the Lord. On what it means to follow Jesus, and what joy there can be in following Jesus. And even when there is no joy, they know you're following Jesus. Because there will be a calmness there that isn't there for those who have no hope. And we are a people of hope. The temple was torn down by the Romans 30 years after Jesus rose again from the dead. Not one block is sitting upon itself. If you ever have the opportunity to go to Jerusalem, I haven't gone there yet, don't know if I ever will, but I saw somebody who had gone brought back a picture, and it was of some of the temple blocks, and they were so big they dwarfed a Volkswagen Beetle that was parked nearby them. These were huge blocks of stone, and the temple is no more. Because when Jesus died, the Gospels tell us something important. And we miss it a lot. The temple curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. Let me tell you what the curtain was. The curtain was the egress to the Holy of Holies space. Only the high priest could go there once a year to make a blood sacrifice to the Lord for the sins of the people. And then the high priest would come back out of this Holy of Holies space and pronounce forgiveness to all the people. And it was sacred. It was so sacred because they believed God came down at that point and was physically in that space. And that to see God's face was to die, as in the Bible. That's why both Moses and Elijah got to see God, but only from the back. They saw his backside, not his face. when Gabriel comes to him while he is in the Holy of Holies, telling him that he and his barren wife Elizabeth are about to have a baby boy, and he's to name him John. And I'm wondering how many people are starting to tug on the rope, because he's in there a little long. And that curtain kept the people from the innermost part of God. That was the Holy of Holies. And when Jesus died, the temple curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. No human came and cut it and ripped it up like this. No, heaven ripped it. Why? Because Jesus is our intermediary. Jesus is our priest. Jesus has died and done the ultimate sacrifice. John the Baptist, Zechariah's son, said, well, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He's the first one who pointed to Jesus and said, this is his function. This is what he's going to do for the people. And Jesus, having made the perfect sacrifice once and for all, means that we can live in freedom and peace and the surety of God's love for us forever. And it all sounds so foolish, so silly. A song that was popular when I was in middle school was, he could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set us free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me. If we were looking at this as a business model plan, we would fire our CEO. If we were to look at this as a lesson plan for school, our principal would be on us like a duck on a June bug. But it's God's plan that he loved us so much that he came to us in human form to go to a cross and die for us, becoming sin for us, so that we can live in freedom, and that freedom allows